those big-headed Sontarans are still waging war. And they have an almighty chip on their shoulder.
They look brilliant. A whole new dynamic of features.
We will ravage this planet!
Because they have no fear of death, they are sort of unstoppable.
Sontarans are ruthless.
They're truly brutal, nasty, monstrous creatures.
It's battle stations for the Doctor Who production team as they plan with military precision the Sontarans' attack against unit forces.
It's big battle time in this episode, and actually it's the first time ever on screen you really get to see the Sontarans en masse. I just want to see hordes of them, armies of them, marching, guns, battleship, action. To see these soldiers, these famous soldiers of the Doctor Who universe, at war, in battle, fighting, and loving it.
All troops, code red.
This is a war!
Get them out of there.
Running like slide bait from a spiel fox.
Get them out of there!
God save us.
North America online. United Kingdom online. North Korea online.
The honor of battle. The glory.
With the coordination of Tom, our stunt coordinator, and Elsa, our choreographer, we really felt the kind of full force of their warrior techniques.
They're truly brutal, nasty, monstrous creatures, and that's what Sontarans are. They fight.
At the moment, we're waiting to go in to shoot the big battle that we're going to be having with the unit troops.
Action!
And shooting various members of them. It's an interesting way to spend the morning, certainly.
What we've seen on there is the soldiers running around, sort of panic, half panicking. And then you have the Sontarans come in into a set line, and they have to work out different scenarios of where they're running, falling, and trying to get away from them, and trying to shoot, but their guns jam.
I think we really did get a sense of scale, and that we had these two kind of big forces facing each other. And then throwing in our, you know, kind of set-piece special effects in episode 5, makes for a very dramatic sequence. One of the pieces of the battle when it commences between the Sontarans and the unit soldiers is when unit call in the Valiant.
Valiant, fire at will.
There's a very good internal corridor with a load of windows down one side, so we decided that would be our kind of blast area.
What we've got this particular effect, we've got Sontarans that are going to be in a military kind of style march. And then they are going to get hit by this almighty kind of boom that's coming from the Valiant. What we've got, if we come in here, we've got a number of air cylinders What we have is an air system, which when I charge these big black cylinders, I call them a woofer, I charge it to a set pressure, and it's got a quick acting valve. When I press a button, it fires lots of air. And inside that is I've got some silicon glass. It looks like broken up glass, but it's just made of silicon, which is completely safe. I've got it on a timer system, so when I press the button, it'll go bang, 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 bang. And so it'll just follow them, and then they'll just take shelter. They're gonna get it. One of the advantages for the Sontarans is they're wearing big helmets and sort of essentially body armor. Because of that, we can fire things at them. I do have an amount of shatter glass which I may put in here. It just adds to the debris and to just essentially just create more mayhem in there. They can be this side when it goes bang.
We just need to see a timing that people walk in on that so they're all cleared in their position.
There's not much in this one.
Keep it more this end, then.
Yeah. I liaise with Danny, who's the SFX supervisor. We work out safe distances, what's going to come through, and the right positions with all the Sontarans. And I just go through them, get them set positions and end positions.
I'm trying to work them in between each of the blasts.
Yeah.
So we've got the blast going.
This kind of position is when it goes bang, basically.
Yeah, so they can tip three steps into this?
Yeah.
Or whatever.
Yeah.
That'd be good, wouldn't it? If we can minimise their steps, then everyone can stand just off the position to walk into them.
So you have Danny, whose business is to do with the physical effects. You've got Tom, who's got to do the stunts. And you've got me, who's got to get from them the bit that I need to tell the story.
Because it's a Valiant blast, I'll be cutting from the Valiant firing to this thing exploding.
Just going off.
Do you know what I mean?
So you don't need to march to him. Then that'd be great, because we've staggered them all, they can all take two or three steps back and on that.
We'll get a little bit of marching.
If we can have three or four steps, that'd be fantastic.
I think that's what we'll do then.
I think the hardest thing for the director on the set is to kind of forget all these things that are dangerous are going on, because the only thing that's important, the only bit that's going to be left behind, is the shot that's in the camera. I think that collaboration is all to do with that focus on that moment.
See then, cheek then, close.
You two come closer.
That's great. Good there, Lanny.
Lovely. Good in there.
Rehearsal. Go, Nick. And left, right, left, right, left, right, left. Bang!
Right. There's someone, one or two, slightly out. I won't mention names. If we can all back up and try that again.
Okay, rehearsing. Left,
right, left, right, left, right, left,
bang!
So
that's better, guys, that's a lot better.
Hopefully it should look quite amazing. You can just see 10 Sontarans marching up and down and all of a sudden the Valiant with an explosion and then just everything blows out and we have 10 people flying down to the ground.
The trick with these sort of sequences is to make them look dangerous, not be dangerous.
With everything set, the pressure's now on the stunt and special effects teams to quite literally blow them all away in just one shot.
And action! Left, right, left, right, left, right!
I was really pleased with it. They're not stunt guys, and they are SAs, and they're really good. They did excellent. They give us everything they did. And obviously, we always work as a team, and I trust Danny. I mean, I really do. Yeah, honest. And yeah, I was really pleased.
We're still visually going over it in your head. One, two, three. You're expecting it, but you're waiting for the poof to actually go with it. But yeah, no, pretty good. Hopefully, it looked good as well on the camera. Saw a load of smoke, and then as I was laying on the floor, I could see the sparks coming from the ceiling. Good fun, though. Getting better and better working on this, isn't it, eh?
That's brilliant!
Getting a taste for it, Doctor?
No, not at all, not me.
We've brought monsters back in the past, mainly Daleks and the Cybermen, and both of those are emotionless robots.
You will identify first.
Identify!
It's like Stephen Hawking meets a speaking clock.
You know, they have those formal speech patterns. And with the Sontarans, it's so nice to have a returning enemy en masse who have just got much more characterful speech.
It seems we must revert to basic Sontaran stratagem one. We will ravage this planet. Prepare weapons, wipe them out, every last stinking human face!
So the Sontarans have been in Doctor Who, I think, four times prior to this.
Work it, make it, do it, makes us harder, better, faster, stronger. Work it, that
don't kill me, can only make me stronger. I need you to hurry up, man, cause I can't wait much longer. I know I got to be right, man, cause I can't get much stronger. Man, I've been waiting all night, man, that's how long I've been on ya.
They first appeared with John Pertwee towards the end of his time, I think.
You are the one called the Doctor?
You know who I am?
I have been expecting you.
That was, in fact, Elizabeth Sladen's first ever story. You should ask her about them.
I'm very fond of the Sontarans. They were my first monster, therefore they were my first shock surprise.
The girl is not of your kind, Diane Gron. The hair is finer, the thorax of a different construction.
And also they returned for me when we were on OB in Dartmoor. You see a monster as a character you've seen before. You have the ammunition. You remember. And it kind of adds another layer.
Thanks. The Sontaran. Can't be.
You may have seen one of us.
But you're identical. The same ugly...
Identical, yes. The same, no.
And then they were used again in the 80s when Colin Baker was the Doctor, Nicola Bryant was Perry, and Patrick Troughton and Fraser Hines came back.
Who was that?
My particular two were, I think, Val and Stike. And they kind of sound warlike, don't they?
Orders.
Yes, sir.
Return to the craft and contact Sontaran High Command.
Bless them, they had to film in Seville in the height of the summer in temperatures of 110 degrees. And they were wearing these all-over rubber suits, these great, huge rubber masks, and within seconds, I mean, they were swimming in perspiration inside, so we had to be quite swift with filming their scenes. Their appearance is kind of functional and brutal and elemental, in a way. There's nothing elegant about them. And they're dead butch.
I think what's striking about them always was the design. Not just the physical design, but also the design of the race, the idea of the race, this kind of bellicose, single-minded bunch of clones who lived to kill, really.
A war. That is excellent.
Oh, so you like war, eh?
Who does not?
They are warlike. They are soldiers. Everything they do is military. They fight. They are bred for war. They love it.
Sontaran attitude. Only one thing matters, to complete the repairs to my ship and return to the glorious war that is my destiny. Nothing must interfere with that, nothing.
Because they have no fear of death, they are sort of unstoppable.
You will face me, sir.
They're a clone race, and the reason why they've developed cloning as a means of reproducing themselves is because they've been fighting a war for 50,000 years, apparently, with their arch enemies, the Rutans, across various galaxies.
The glorious Sontaran army reckons its numbers in hundreds of millions.
They have just the one weakness, I mean, apart from looking in the mirror, which must depress them unutterably.
They have a probing vent at the back of their neck. I love that. It means they always have to face their enemies. Their only weakness is on the back of their head, which over the years on Doctor Who has been dealt with in all sorts of brilliant ways.
That's how you see them off, really. Shoot something into their probic vent. Sounds appalling, doesn't it?
They're very easy to describe. You sort of get what they are, I think. You know, the idea of what this race should be, and the look is very striking. You know, the sort of baked potato head.
Didn't I tell you, you might not find my face pleasing?
And it's a great gag, which is they've done every time they've appeared. But you've got this dome-shaped helmet which they remove, and the head's exactly the same shape underneath. It's great.
The brief with the Sontaran really was to keep that the traditional look of the Sontaran, the way the head looks, the way it looked in the 70s, that lovely dome shape. But obviously now, 30, 40 years on, we can totally update the technology. Now it's actually a prosthetic makeup. It's in two pieces. There's the large dome part of his head, and then there's a facial piece which goes on. We actually glue it down to the whole face so that as the performer moves their face, everything moves with the face.
Wonderful.
I always wanted Sontarans to be short. That's my mental image of them.
I think the initial idea was that they were quite squat, and then I think they got quite tall, but we've got them. We've made them squat again.
What are you going to do? Bite our ankles?
One of the design briefs for the Sontarans would be that they were quite short and stocky creatures. So we picked a size basically saying we'd go with 5 foot tall.
Doctor, you impugn my honour!
Yeah, I'm really glad you didn't say belittle, because then I'd have a field day.
So fortunately we got cast Chris Ryan, who is 5 foot tall and is a fabulous actor.
The planet is going nuclear! I admire them! The bravery of idiots is bravery nonetheless.
My body, head, arms, everything, whole thing was cast in some sort of material to create a new body, a Sontaran body.
He's literally like a statue. He's encased, covered in plaster.
The cast had to be taken off the whole body, the arms, the hands. Because it takes time for these things to set, you have to keep as still as possible.
It's an unpleasant experience at best. He's got to stand still for about an hour.
And so I had my hands held onto a bar at the front, stood in a position feet apart.
Once that's all set, we can crack it open, open up the body mould. And then we fill it up with fiberglass and casting materials, and that gives us our copy of Chris. We decided to build everything around Chris and then try and fit other people to effectively his costume.
I think the armour the Sontarans have now is a cousin of the armour that they had before. They used to be padded, and we wanted something that was more armour-like, just stronger. Like, I think they wear metal shells because they're soldiers.
It's no small task transforming these five-foot performers into an armed force. Early in the morning, the cast arrived to get ahead with their costume.
It's 8 o'clock in the morning, and we'll get our makeup.
Our faces glued on for another 3 hours.
And heads, which will be about 3 hours. Yeah. And then we start. It'll be quite a long day, I think, today.
Yes.
There's a lot to do.
Hello. Hiya. Hiya. Hey. Come on, man.
It was fun, but there was a lot of pressure because physically we felt quite constrained with the what we had to wear.
First of all, you've got these big arm sections here that which are made out of sort of like foam sewn onto a kind of lycra sleeve. So first of all, it's slightly snug fit, so you've got to really force your arm down into it. And also you've got to have these on before they put on the prosthetic head because you can't put the head on and then put the arms on. So this is the first stage of it, which gives you this wonderful American footballer kind of look here.
We forget we've got this thing on, and the work is so intense, just being there and just trying to remember where you are and what you're doing and what you've got to say, you actually forget how extraordinary these characters appear. Some people do give you very strange looks, and you can't understand why. You get to feel very paranoid, actually. There's a lot to be done. It will take, the best part of 3 hours, isn't that right, Martin?
Yeah, 2.5 to 3 hours, yeah. Altogether.
Altogether, before we even see the set.
First thing we put on is the ball cap here, just to keep the hair out of the way. So that's just the headpiece that just goes on. There you are. And then,
once this is on, the hearing is deadened by quite a lot, and then when we've got the scenes with the helmets on, it's even more difficult to hear.
We make one face for it today. I think it's probably we made 8 for Dan and probably 6 or 7 for Chris.
picked up, apart from my gloves and my collar, so I'm just going to nip back to my trailer, get my paraphernalia there, and then I'll be called to set.
Even Sontarans like having the makeup done sometimes. You can't put beauty second just because you're taking over the planet.
400 million weapons! Sontar!
Wish everyone to give them that testosterone.
Sontar-Ha!
They just needed that sort of release, that joy in battle, beyond just saying, I'm having fun. So I thought that child brought out their aggression and their rituals, and also their fun, but also the fact they're all of one like mind, they are clones, they all do things together, they all join in with exactly the same action, the same words. It just seems really Sontaran to do that.
Probably about 3 or 4 weeks ago, when the guys first came together for the first time, we did a few basic exercises, just running things, just some marching, just to get everybody in the feel of the quality of movement that we were actually looking for.
Okay, and 3, 2, 1, action!
400 million weapons! Sontar-Ha! Sontar-Ha!
I seem to remember saying that quite a few times.
Sontar-Ha! 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 Sontar-Ha!
My left palm was very sore at the end of, after each session of my Sontar-Ha-ing.
Sontar-Ha! 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 Sontar-Ha!
Give me a break.
We're setting up the final scene of the day, where the Sontarans have successfully nicked the TARDIS using their teleport device. So a wall is being taken down in that set over there.
Yeah, I'll go and have a lie down a moment in Bega.
So they can actually bring the TARDIS in, because it's rather big. It's 8:13, and I'm drinking a cup of soup through a straw, and I'm looking forward for the wrap quite soon.
The spoils of war!
The Doctor's infamous vessel in Sontaran hands!
It's time I made a move, sir. I have soldiers of my own. I'll tell them of the honor and the glory, sir. I'll tell them the planetfall is coming!
It's funny, there is something innately slightly sinister about a child genius, isn't there? Because it doesn't quite fit with the natural way of things.
Suppose you're the Doctor.
Hello.
Your commanding officer phoned ahead.
Ah, but I haven't got a commanding officer. Have you?
He's kind of a bit of a dream role to play because he's got all these great elements like genius and megalomaniac.
Cool.
He's a character who has just somewhere gone off the rails. He's brilliant, he's incredibly intelligent, but he's cast himself as an outsider.
We spent all our lives excluded, the clever ones, and they've laughed at us. And pulled us down, those ordinary people out there, this cattle.
He sees himself as a kind of savior. I think he's quite embittered, and he's sort of trying to save these group of students, and he feels like he can give them the new world that they're all trying to create.
It's a lost little boy, really. He's a genius who's never had a friend. I don't think he's even got a family, actually. There's something very, very lonely about that boy. And it's so childish, the way his loneliness has come out as aggression and megalomania and ambition. Ridiculous plans. Ridiculous plans to move to another planet.
There was no planet fall. Castor 36, indeed. We only needed you for installation of the Atmos system.
No, but I'm on your side. I did everything you wanted.
He's a bit of an anti-doctor. He's someone who the Doctor recognises something very similar in Luke Rattigan to himself.
Not easy, is it? Being clever.
You look at the world and you connect things. Random things. You think, why can't anyone else see it? The rest of the world is so slow.
Yeah.
And you're on your own.
I know.
He's quite keen to bring Luke down a peg or two from the start because he can smell that things are spiralling out of control.
Inventing zero carbon cars. Saving the world.
a man with vision.
Mmm. Blinkered vision. It's often good with a great big alien race to give them a human ally. It's someone for them to reflect off, bounce with. It's someone who can have conversations with them that the Doctor can't have. The Doctor just opposes them and tries to stop them. So, through Luke, I think we get to know the Sontarans a little better.
Glorious warfare! 10th Sontaran battle fleet, we move to the final phase. Prepare the subjugation of Earth for the glory of Sontar!
From the start of episode 5, we leave in episode 4 and then continue in episode 5, we find the whole world choking on the Sontar gas that's been activated.
All soldiers to withdraw! Bukowski, take the soldiers into the factory. Make the area secure. Seal off doors and windows.
Once I got the idea of the cars being the principal threat that the Sontarans used, then it seemed obvious that what we wanted to use was a kind of alien, very toxic form of exhaust fumes. It was very exciting writing two scripts with huge, lavish descriptions of alien gas belching out of the back of the cars and enveloping towns and choking people, etc.
A foggy day in London town, I had me low, I had me down, I viewed the morning with such alarm. British Museum had lost its charm.
Just that he's filming with smoke is an absolute nightmare because it is the element of special effects that's most at the mercy of the elements.
More smoke, I'm hearing more smoke from Douglas.
It took us by surprise, the smoke, because actually we set aside a fair bit of CGI money to create the smoke that we never spent in the end, because actually the effects guys, Danny and his team from Any Effects, created the smoke effect so brilliantly. I never thought it would be that simple.
There are different types of smoke. It depends on the scene. If it's a big shot, we have these big sort of cellophane tubes which pump stuff out. For close-ups, we have just little smoke guns which pump out something more akin to just a sort of standard dry ice.
These are the smaller machines we've got. It's an RTM pistol. It's heated by gas, which travels down the middle of a copper coil, and the fluid travels through the copper coil, vaporizes, means we can fill a large area of smoke. We've got a large machine called a medium, which is more static, and you might have seen our lay flat, the tubing that we run out, so one man can cover a huge area of smoke.
I was much more fearful, actually, as a kind of successful element in this about smoke than I would be about fire or snow or rain or anything, because the wind blows and you have to reroute it all the other way. It's a really tricky one to get right, and also it changes the whole time. Not for one second will it stay the same. Continuity is a nightmare. If the wind starts to gust up, there's absolutely nothing we can do.
You do feel it, you know, it tangs a little bit, and it's not the most pleasant thing.
A foggy day in London town. I had me low. I had me down. I viewed the morning with such alarm. The old British Museum had lost its charm.
It's not actually causing you. I hope it's not causing me any harm. Cut back to me next year with an iron lung.
And now walk back into the corner.
As Sontaran smoke chokes the earth, the most unlikely hero appears through the mist.
I guessed. He's gonna choke! Stop now!
I'm going open!
Don't just stand there, get him out!
Yet again, the mum solves everything. It's like all the men are running about panicking and screaming. Mum comes in with an axe.
So it'll be that angle, is that okay?
That's okay.
Yep.
That's and brilliant. There. Yeah, so we're sure.
Da-dun, da-dun, and then da-dun,
da-dun. I love the fact she keeps an axe by the front door in case of burglars. Like she'd attack burglars with an axe, but no nonsense, Sylvia. Going straight to the rescue.
But don't just stand there, get him out!
Sylvia does become the hero in that moment, but then I think that's part of what Doctor Who does. It makes heroes out of unlikely people. It's part of what the Doctor does. He's an enabler. He brings out the extraordinary in people. partly because he puts them in situations where they've never been before and they really sort of, it's sink or swim. And I think that's what's happening with Sylvia.
We've had Sylvia come and axe the car.
Action!
I had to do the, I don't know what it's called technically, but it's just where you swing and you stop at that point. But don't just stand there, get him out!
What we're doing is we're seeing for real with the windscreen in, Sylvia through the windscreen with a rubber axe and a reverse of the Wilf in the car. Then we're going to take this out, put some silicone glass there for after, so it looks like Wilf sitting there with a load of shattered glass around it. And then we're going to get a piece of deck glass and shoot through that, the actual moment of impact. So actually, we've never had to do anything in the car, you know, other than take the windscreen out.
Sadly, they wouldn't let me do it. I so wanted to. I've told everyone it would have been, you know, a fortune in psychotherapy to just be able to smash a windscreen. Two stunt people had to come in and cover for me.
Clear it, keep it clear, Hedy. Turn over, quiet now.
One being the producer, fair enough, she's a very attractive lady. I was thrilled.
Okay, three, two, one.
And look out, Bernard.
The other one, Danny. I'm sorry. A man replacing me. And he had smaller hands than me, which is also upsetting.
Things I do for Doctor Who, honestly.
So I just got to watch. Chip says you're handling
I'll be in something.
Yeah.
Danny and I just set that up as a second unit. Camera lock off. It's a proper piece of glass with some dets on it. Camera locked off behind it, and I think we've got Danny and Sylvia's thing with his hairy arms to whack it.
Thank you.
Okay. Now, guys, smoke up.
Danny, you ready?
Yes, sorry.
We're at speed, boys.
It's going to make a loud bang.
Okay, step away. Okay. Here we go. And three, two.
Oh, hang on, let's not rush it. You are.
Right, a bit more smoke in that side, Dan. Okay, forget it, Dan. And
this is going to be the first one, yeah?
This is the one, yeah?
Yeah. Ready?
Okay, set. You armed?
Yeah.
Okay.
Three, two, one. Well done.
Can I have Jack's back inside, please?
Well, Henry, my colleague, fired it just at the right time, so everyone's safe. It's better for me to do it than anyone else, so that's the reason why I'm dressed like this.
Great. So I could have done a bigger swing. Don't just stand there, get him out!
It's a good chance, when we come back to Earth mid-series, it's a good chance for the companion to develop, to see that, for example, Donna gets her key to the TARDIS.
Oh! Never given you a key. Keep that. Go on, that's yours. Quite a big moment, really.
She's given a key to the TARDIS, yeah. Which, in kind of true Donna fashion, she goes, yeah, never mind. Don't get all sentimental about it, because I'm actually choking to death.
What's perhaps different to the Doctor and Donna's relationship, to relationships that we've seen the Doctor have before, is that Donna herself feels no need to prove herself.
God, this air's disgusting.
This is bad for me. Go get out the TARDIS.
Oh! I'm never giving you a key. She's very much her own woman, and I think the Doctor, therefore, goes along with that. Keep that. Go on, that's yours.
Can't make a moment,
really.
Yeah. Maybe we get all sentimental after the
world's
finished choking to death.
Yeah, good idea.
Donna's not been waiting going on. You know, are you going to tell me the, are you going to tell me the alarm code? You know what I mean? I don't think she's really reading into that in any way.
Donna just forces herself upon him. Donna just inhabits the Doctor's life from the moment she steps on board.
I can't believe I'm doing this!
No, neither can I.
So I think, that, for instance, the moment when the Doctor gives her a TARDIS key, I think he just assumed he'd already done it.
Actually, he treats it in a much more cavalier way than either Rose or Martha did. None of that nonsense. Just give me the key. Thank you very much. World's choking to death.
With Rose, and possibly even more with Martha, there was always a sense that perhaps they felt they didn't quite deserve to be there.
What's happened? Where are you?
Still on Earth, but don't worry. I've got my secret weapon.
And what's that?
You.
Somehow that's not making me happy.
Companion alone on an alien spaceship, and all she's got is a hammer. It's like there's something really dreadful about that. I mean, genuinely full of dread in the doctor isn't there and he isn't there to save her.
It's a scary place to be. It's very alone.
I find that very, very scary. It's one of my favourite sequences because you think of the loneliness of it.
Right, Donna, listen, on the back of his neck, on his collar, there's a sort of plug, like a hole, the probic vent. One blow to the probic vent knocks him out.
He's going to kill me.
She does have a wobble, and it's quite unusual because we haven't really seen that from her because she is quite sure of who she is. She's quite sure of what she can do and what she can't do.
I can't even mend a fuse.
Donna, stop talking about yourself like that. You can do this, I promise.
So when the doctor really has to push her, it feels new, and he's sorry for it.
What if they find me?
I know, and I wouldn't ask, but there is nothing else I can do. The whole planet is choking, Donna.
So the doctor almost regrets having to kind of push her into situations where she wouldn't feel entirely comfortable. But of course he does, because he has to, and of course she fulfills it, because she is perhaps more able than she believes herself to be.
She rises to the occasion, yeah, she does. And I think she sort of finds this sort of strength within her, and I don't know if she knew she had it, because she's cocky and she's mouthy and she's ballsy, but doesn't necessarily mean she's brave in the face of alien warfare. But turns out she is.
There's something very human about that. She doesn't sort of suddenly become some superhero and step up to the mark in a way that's just a bit too much.
And action.
Back of the neck. Here's a little bit of trivia for you. It was supposed to be a shoe. But because I'll only wear trainers, they didn't want it to be a trainer, or thought probably a trainer would be too soft, it would just bounce off the back of his neck. So I've had to have a night. I'm through.
Oh, you are brilliant, you are.
Shut up.
Perhaps previously he's been more used to being admired and slightly goggled at.
With every passing story, Donna becomes more of a companion. And in the second half of the series now, there's some really brilliant stuff to come.
And it's part of the new, it's part of the different flavour that Donna brings.
Hello.
Wiped out, cause I had some plans, yeah. Wiped out, destiny in my own hands. I thought I'd get by without you.
Donna Noble, since you didn't ask, I'll have a salute.
Mark.
Thank you. You would be...
The Doctor and Donna Noble.
Representing the Noble Corporation PLC Limited Intergalactic. It's always like this for you, isn't it?
Oh, yes. And off we go.
Can't get along without you. Can't get along without you.
We wanted like a great big explosive ending. Because actually that's what the Sontarans are. You live by war, you die by war. So with all their guns and armor and attitude, they just deserve to be blown out of the sky, frankly.
Just send that thing up on its own, I don't know. Put it on a delay.
I can't.
Why not?
I
I've got to give them a choice.
To stop the Sontarans in the end, he has to threaten them with extinction. But of course, because he's the Doctor, he has to give them the choice.
Action! Oh, excellent!
General Stark, you know what this is. But there's another option. You can leave. Just go! Sontaran High Command need never know what happened here.
Your stratagem would be wise if Sontarans feared death. But we do not. At arms!
I'm giving you the chance to leave.
As he beams up to that ship, he knows it's a kind of suicide.
It's putting a man in the middle of a war and giving him the button that will stop the war, but the one man in the whole universe who won't press it. And I just love that dilemma, because would he have done it? Could he have done it? I'm glad that we'll never know.
The blessing of the Doctor is that he made Luke see that there was another choice.
What are you doing?
Something clever.
In that one sort of moment of self-sacrifice at the end, he gets a chance to redeem himself.
He's not the bad guy. He makes a bold move and martyrs himself for the sake of the world, because he just needs to... Something just clicks inside him.
And actually, by coming into contact with the Doctor, only he actually matures into his proper intelligence and saves the day in the end.
Don't forget it's Saturday, which means we have a film for you tonight here on BBC Three, and said film is High Fidelity, starring John Cusack, Jack Black and Catherine Zeta-Jones. That's at 9:10. Next up, though, The Real Hustle, and that's followed by Top Gear.